Hello, I'm Dr. Mary Jo Taylor, Assistant Manager of the Improving Mathematics Instruction Research Alliance, which is part of the Southeast Regional Educational Laboratory, one of 10 laboratories from across the United States that provides technical assistance and research support to universities, districts, and schools. Our alliance members, who are State Department of Education mathematics leaders, district math curriculum specialists, and university staff, stated that they wanted to support mathematics educators as they begin the new school year and focus on what is most important when reconnecting with their students this fall. They wanted to equip teachers with the tools they need to help their students feel comfortable and safe in a somewhat changed environment and motivate them to engage in active learning after several months of independent learning and little social interaction. This two-part video series features Pam Harris, former teacher, consultant, and author of several books, including Building Powerful Numeracy and Discovering Advanced Algebra. In part one, Pam will give us some ideas on ways teachers can address their students' continuing social and emotional needs while instituting best practices for teaching. In part two, she will focus on ways to leverage students' different mathematical strengths as a resource for learning and on the National Council of Teachers Mathematics Effective Teaching Practices.
Welcome back to school, or at least welcome back to teaching in whatever form it might take. I'm Pam Harris, mathematics teacher educator. I have a passion for teaching mathematics in a way that is accessible and meaningful, empowering students and teachers to think and reason mathematically. We live in unprecedented times. In the recent past, schools and teaching have been disrupted in unparalleled ways. The National Council of Teachers of Mathematics, together with the National Council of Supervisors of Mathematics, have issued a joint statement in which they state, "Although no one can predict how education might look in the coming months, it is in the best interests of our students to strategize how we might best meet their needs in the upcoming months." We couldn't agree more. It is with that spirit that we bring you this video. We'll present some considerations, questions, and potential solutions to giving students the best start. We'll also show how effective mathematics teaching practices can provide crucial direction to address the challenges that teachers are facing now and in the months to come. Before we dive into math content, let's consider some of the stressors on both teachers and students in the past year. COVID-19, the virus currently causing a global pandemic, will continue to be a global disruptor of normalcy. This wide-scale interruption to everything from school scheduling to toilet paper supply is unprecedented in our lifetime. Unfortunately, it is very likely that we will see resurgent waves of infection for some time. The good news is that we can and will adapt. As COVID-19 hit the global stage in 2020, schools changed dramatically. Businesses, churches, and schools closed. Many teachers started spring break as planned, only to not return to school. And things still may not have returned to normal. With schools out and children at home, the possibilities of student circumstances differing widely are greater than ever. You may have had students who had a parent at home with time and resources to help. Some students were required to do more on their own. Other students may have had access to technology and the resources to take advantage of that technology, while others may have had limited or no access to technology. And many students may just not have done much school at all. Some may have been isolated and suffered the effects of that and their parents' isolation. Some may have had the virus or lost loved ones to it. How did all these things affect some of our most at-risk populations, like students in poverty, students with special needs, and English language learners? And amid the storm of new stress and trauma brought by COVID-19, awareness of racial inequality has become more and more prevalent. Systemic injustices have long sickened and torn apart communities nationwide. Recent tragedies have galvanized many to action. The increased acknowledgement and advocacy bring about sentiments of both loss and opportunity. Loss of freedom as a result of racial inequality that could have been addressed and prevented a long time ago, but also opportunity to make lasting improvement in society as we work together for a better future. All this together means that the effect on student goes far beyond what can be described as merely unplanned and extended summer break. As the National Council of Supervisors in Mathematics, NCSM, and the National Council of Teachers of Mathematics, NCTM, wrote in their joint position statement, moving forward into the 2020-2021 academic year will require attention to educators' and learners' social, emotional, and academic needs. Many critical decisions and bold leadership are necessary, but we must be mindful that these decisions will affect the lives of people. With that in mind, let's address students' social and emotional needs and position students' humanity at the center of our attention. Because as Maya Angelou, poet and author, said, I have learned that people will forget what you said, people will forget what you did, but people will never forget how you made them feel. As you begin the 2021 school year, consider reaching out to each student individually. A personal email, note, phone call, or some other appropriate way to let each student know that they have been noticed, seen, and acknowledged. Learn students' names as quickly as possible. Use their names in communications. Ask questions to help you get to know each student. Perhaps more than ever before, intentionally seek to build a solid teacher-student relationship. It doesn't matter the age. All students enjoy personal contact and connection with a teacher. A student that is stressed and uncertain is a student difficult to reach. Only by fostering, nurturing, and capitalizing on the student-teacher relationship can that gulf of trauma be bridged. So teachers, what are we to do? Julianne Turner from the University of Notre Dame and colleagues demonstrate in a research study that four motivational principles, belongingness, competence, autonomy, and meaningfulness, when attended to using intentional instructional strategies, influence a student's willingness to engage in academic tasks. Let's look at each of them one at a time. Belongingness is the need to establish close relationships with others. Students need to feel they belong with teachers and their peers. We have all had experience in classrooms where we can see status at work. Students who are smart in math, students who are popular, students who seem like they're on the fringes. So how do we build belongingness in the classroom? It begins with us and how we treat students, not only accepting but truly honoring differences and celebrating uniqueness in our classrooms. Allowing students to have choice and ownership of the room, the goals, and the tone of the community. As you set up your norms, involve students. Every student is unique and brings to the table unique strategies for solving problems. When a third grade student describes his subtraction strategy and represents that strategy visibly for the group, ask other students to reflect and comment on it by asking, "Will Jose's strategy work every time? How do you know?" You are honoring students' thinking and celebrating their unique approach, making space for them as competent members of the community. When an algebra student gets an answer wrong but has just described beautiful reasoning with a small computational error, focus the conversation around the thinking and the relationships used. Allow the student to correct her own error and notice the student's cleverness or efficiency or perseverance. Showing that you respect all students and that there is respect between students lends to the positive environment that fosters belongingness. When a kindergarten through second grade student takes longer than others to reason through a story problem, give him the space and time to make sense for himself, gently preventing others from jumping in to save the student. Letting others jump in to save a student by answering for them sends the message that speed and recall are more important than reasoning. Jumping in also communicates a belief that the student cannot do the work and is not a contributing member of the community. Again, honoring differences and uniqueness and respect. That brings us to the next need, competence. Competence, in simplest terms, is the need to feel successful. We can build competence as we teach content by giving appropriately challenging tasks, using open-ended questions, and encouraging a growth mindset. Appropriately challenging tasks help build competence by giving students opportunities to explore, make conjectures, defend their choices, and refine their ideas. These actions feel like success, growth, that learning is occurring. These tasks succeed better when teachers ask open questions because students build competence as they make valid arguments and critique the reasoning of others. Our challenge is to help students gain a growth mindset instead of a fixed mindset that says, I am either smart or dumb at math and I will stay that way, versus a growth mindset which believes that brains are changeable and everyone can improve and grow their math ability. Challenging tasks include those with multiple solution paths, like Kathy Fosno's taking inventory tasks, where kindergartners and first grade students inventory various classroom materials, where students can count by ones, but also can group items by tens and begin to notice place value patterns. Or we can ask middle and high school students to collect data and make predictions based on patterns, from single variable patterns like data spread and measures of center, to bivariate patterns where students write appropriate function models. Open-ended questions like, how do you know? How did you solve it? Why do you think that works or doesn't work? How are you making sense of that? You might ask a second or third grade student, would you rather remove or find the difference between the numbers for that subtraction problem? Why do you think that's a good strategy for this situation, for these numbers? You might ask a fifth grade student the same questions when choosing to divide or choosing to use equivalent ratios to solve a rate problem. What does encouraging a growth mindset look like? In as early as a K-2 classroom, students can be asked to look back on their own work and wonder or reflect, ask questions, verbalize what they have learned. We can model how reflection affects choices made in the future by asking, would I make this same move again? What did I learn for next time? Middle and high school students can and should be encouraged regularly that they have perspectives worth contributing and reminded that learning only occurs when met with challenge, that those challenges prepare them for future efforts. Autonomy is the psychological need to behave according to my interests or values. The opposite of autonomy is dependence, where students wait to be told how to do every step of a problem or ask what steps they should write down. Autonomy can be seen in the classroom when students have choices about how to solve a problem. They can enact their own strategies based on what they are thinking about recording, what is helpful for them in solving the problem. Let's talk about a few strategies teachers can use to build student autonomy. Allowing students choice in how they approach a problem. Listening carefully to their thinking. And giving them opportunities to question and discuss strategies openly. The instructional routines of problem strings and number talks encourage student autonomy because they not only allow for, but encourage students to solve problems using their own reasoning. In the routines, students might record only what is needed for them to keep track of their thinking because they have the autonomy to choose what to record. A problem string might ask students to find 8 times 7, then 80 times 7, then 79 times 7. Students can solve the problems using any strategy, but the purposeful order of the problems can help students realize that they can use the problem before to help them. Ending the string with a problem without helpers allows students to generalize the pattern and apply it to a new problem. Ask students how they are visualizing the relationships. Sketch visual models like open arrays or ratio tables to help make the thinking visible so more students can join in the discussion. By asking students to explain their thinking and make it visible for the class to discuss, students' sense of autonomy is strengthened because their choices are being celebrated. Their thinking is worth considering. Students become more inclined to make choices according to their interests in the future instead of relying on a teacher directive. A similar problem string in high school is to ask students to sketch a graph of the quadratic y equals x squared, then the line y equals 3x, then their combination y equals x squared plus 3x. The teacher should represent the different strategies that students use, including y equals x times the quantity x plus 3. If that strategy doesn't come up naturally, that's the next problem in the string. Then students continue to graph the rest of the problems. Sharing strategies, the teacher modeling and helping draw relationships, and making connections. Because students choose the strategies or created the strategies that are being compared and related, students' autonomies are strengthened. The fourth principle to encourage student engagement is meaningfulness. Meaningfulness pertains to developing interest in or appreciation for content and experiencing its authentic application. A way to teach mathematics is to show students steps, practice them, and then ask students to apply to word problems. We suggest instead starting with contextual problems that make the mathematics realizable for students, where students can find and use patterns, and they can feel the authentic application. This could look like students starting with contexts like 27 sticks of gum in a pack, then finding the number of sticks in 100 packs, 99 packs, 50 packs, and 49 packs. Or starting with $2.50 for 32 ounces of gummy worms, and then finding how many ounces they could buy for $5, $10, $1, or how much it would cost for 16 ounces, 8 ounces, 4 ounces, 2 ounces, 1 ounce, the unit rate. If we give students contextual problems like these, they will be more meaningful because it will help keep students grounded in the context, so they do not just start throwing numbers or variables around, but instead they reason about contexts like sticks and packs, about gummy worms and money. So, what is your role in moving forward? Due to COVID-19, we have the opportunity thrust upon us to be innovative and think purposefully about culture and structures. Well, at the start of every school year, we say to ourselves, I want to reach every child. This year, it's an issue for different reasons. Let's use this disruption to make the changes we really want to make. Let's leverage what is different about this school year to create cultures and systems that are effective. Together, we can move forward and give students the best start. In part two, I'll talk more about how the standards for mathematical practice and the effective teaching practices can help you decide how to start the school year. Hope you can join me.